All right, we're back for the third and final installment of our punch and drift video. I think today we're going to be able to get everything finished off. We're going to go into the heat treat process and some general instructions on heat treating. And then we'll heat treat the punch and the drift. And then we'll wrap it up. And I hope you've enjoyed it. And enjoy the rest of the video. Thanks. While the forge heats up, let's just talk a little bit about the hardening and tempering process. I'm hoping this little remote mic allows you to hear me over the roar of the forge. These are junkyard steels. They are a relative unknown. I have a pretty good idea of what I think they are, but I can't swear to it. And I'm pretty comfortable with what I think they are because both of these are things that I've used before and have figured out what to do. If you've never used a steel before, I suggest you do some testing. One of the first things to do is a spark test. Before you ever make a tool out of it, put it on a grinder if you have one, and just about any grinder, angle grinder, belt grinder, a 6-inch hard wheel grinder will work, and look at the spark pattern. There's a lot of books out there that'll kind of explain what you're looking for. But spark something that you know is mild steel and look at the sparks. Then maybe take the corner of an old file and run it on the grinder and look at the sparks. The sparks in the file will be much brighter and much more complex, meaning it has more carbon. Different alloys are going to work a little bit differently, but after time you'll start to develop a sense of whether it's a medium or a high carbon steel, or whether it's some sort of an exotic steel, which sometimes, even though it hardens, doesn't have much of a spark pattern. I know that seems confusing, but that's part of what you have to work your way through while you're learning to start experiencing different things. And if you have known steels, then you can compare the sparks of a known steel with your mystery steel and get some idea of how high the carbon content is. While you start working those mystery steels or junkyard steels, I suggest you draw a piece out to a small cross section. Just cut a little sample, draw it out. This is quarter by half. Bring it up to critical temperature. The way we generally test critical temperature is with a magnet. If the magnet doesn't stick, it's probably hot enough to harden. That's accurate for simple steels. It is not accurate for complex, high-tech steels like H13. That's a whole different ball game. But using 4140, 5160, W1, 01, testing for critical temperature with a magnet is pretty accurate. If it doesn't stick, it's at or above critical temperature. And you want to test it on the way up frequently, because if you just let it sit till it's bright orange, well, it's going to be above critical temperature, but you don't know how much, and you don't want to get it too hot or you're liable to crack it. After you've established that it's hot enough, let this piece air cool. Just stand it up, lock it device, walk away from it, let it air cool. After that, test it with a file. That piece cuts very easily with a file air cooled. So clearly it did not harden in air, so it is not an air hardening steel. Heat it up again. This time quench it in oil. Olive oil is not a bad solution. I would preheat it though, up to about 200 degrees, 300. Too warm to put your hand in, but not boiling. And quench it in the oil. If it does not, test it with the file again. If the file skates, it's hard. You don't need to know anything else. If the file still cuts, does it cut as easily as it did when it was air hardened? Is it tougher to cut? If it's tougher to cut, you're getting close. But the next thing to try would be water. Does it harden? Same procedure. Heat it to critical temperature, quench it in water, test it with a file. Does it harden? If the file skates, then it's hard in water. it doesn't in hardened water, you might try it in a very strong salt water or brine solution, but probably you're dealing with a steel that isn't going to harden the way you want it to. For these tools, if I can cut it with a file, but it's difficult, it doesn't cut as easily as the soft steel, that's probably ideal. These aren't, well, I'm not making knives or chisels here, I'm making blacksmithing tools. They don't need to be super hard, they just need to be hard enough to hold their shape when you're working with them. And they're gonna get abused and dinged up anyways, and you're gonna have to keep them under maintenance. So that's the basic process of testing steels to see if they're air hardening, oil hardening, or water hardening. And I'd always go in that order, because you haven't really hurt a water hardening steel by trying to harden it in air. Whereas if you harden it in water and it's an air hardening steel, the piece is liable to crack, and then you're going to have to make a new sample piece to finish your test with. So you might as well start with the easier quench like air first. As a new smith, I'd stay away from air hardening steels for a while. They can be wonderful things, but they can also be really frustrating. Okay, we're going to start. I'm going to do the punch. Now this punch only has to be hard down here. The struck end you don't want very hard, because that's going to ding up your hammer and is more likely to knock a chip off of here. So actually leaving that soft is just fine. Or you can harden the whole thing and then just temper that a little bit more. But let's plan to just harden most of this. And we're going to put it in the fire. And I'm going to turn the gas pressure down. I don't want to harden this too fast, or I don't want to bring it up to temperature too fast. So I might as well run this just as low as this forge will let me go, and bring it up to heat slowly. Okay, this is starting to get just a little bit of color. Now that magnet sticks up there. Oh, see, but it doesn't stick very well there. It still sticks a little. So we're getting close. Now we want to harden back from the edge a little bit, so I'm going to have to heat that up a little more than I might like. I'm going to shut the back burner off on the forge, so I'm just heating the tool right in this area is more than I am here. This gets hot easier anyways, and I'd like to be able to harden about this much of it. That's all that has to be hardened. The rest of this can be left fairly soft. It's a tough steel to start with, and even fully annealed, it's tougher than mild steel. And as thick as it is, this isn't going to be a problem bending. It just doesn't have to be hard. Don't take a chance on breaking the tool. Okay, that doesn't stick. So we really know this is about the right color, and that's just a little bit hotter than I would like it. But again, that's one of the problems with working in a forge, is you tend to overheat the thin sections before you get the thick part. So now I'm going to go into oil. Oh, we're going to have to zoom out here. We're going to quench this in oil. And I use a commercial heat treating oil. I think I'd rather use the olive oil, I just haven't bought it yet. And I'm going to work that up and down and around in circles, and I'm only going to quench the last 2 inches or so. And then I'm going to slowly withdraw it so that I'm only quenching about an inch. And that helps avoid a sharp transition from the quenched steel to the unquenched. And once I'm pretty sure that is completely cooled down, now I'm leaving that hot in the middle. I don't know if you can see that in the camera or not. There's still color here. And that's important. We're going to use that to temper it with. Now I'm going to abrade this with a brick real quick. Scratch up my nice finish I just put on there. And by doing so, I don't know if you're going to be able to see this or not, me find the camera. There we go. We can watch the colors run. You can kind of see up there at the heel, there's a blue color. We want to get this down into a straw or just the beginning of a peacock or dark blue. But it's that heat in the middle of the chisel that's running that. And once that gets to that color, then we'll quench it again and stop the temper colors from running. Those are just oxides. And when people say, oh, you overground your tool, it turned blue, that's what they're looking at. And that's just about where I want it, right there. So we're going to quench that again. And this time we can quench the entire tool. The rest of that tool is cooled off well below critical temperature, so it's not going to harden it at this point. But we don't want it to run any more temper. The other option is to quench the whole thing and either temper it using a torch or clean the oil off and put it in your kitchen oven at 500 degrees. That's a pretty good way to harden and temper, or to temper. Leaving it full hard, you're pretty well risking a crack. There are some steels that don't require tempering, or they refer to as self-tempering. This isn't one of them. So now that's cool enough. It's not going to continue to temper itself anymore. So we're going to move to the drift. Now these drifts out of jackhammer bits don't get real hard in oil. I think they're better off hardened in water if you were making a cutting tool. But a drift is not a cutting tool. It just needs to be tough enough to support the eye while you're working on the eye of your tool. So hardening in oil is going to result in a very tough tool, even though it is not a very hard tool. And that's a hard concept to get around sometimes. But hardness is brittle, it breaks easy, but it'll hold an edge. Tough means that it probably won't hold an edge, but it's hard to break, but also easier to bend and deform. So you need a good balance between the two, and depending on the tool is what you're going to want. Now again, I've shut down the back burner on the forge here so that I'm mostly heating in the front part of the forge, and I'm pushing this all the way through so that little thin tip of the drift, this part right here, is going to heat a little bit slower than the rest, because I really want the drift to be mostly hardened. I don't want the struck end where I might drive it in with a hammer hard, but most of it needs to be pretty hard, or as hard as I'm going to get it, which is not real hard, to function well and not deform and dent and ding up any worse than it has to. Okay, now the drift is pretty evenly hot. Magnet doesn't stick. There's one spot that doesn't quite look even. I just want it good and even before I quench it. Now I'm going to quench the entire thing, and we're going to have to temper this differently. So that's all the way down in the oil. I want to oscillate it around so it doesn't form an air cushion. When you're quenching things like this in water or oil, the water in the oil can boil, and that leaves it air bubbles around the piece, and that insulates it from the cooler liquid. So you want to keep it moving to keep that air curtain from forming. But like I say, this thing, because I want it to be an even hardness throughout, with the exception of the struck end, which was not up to heat, I'm going to put it in an oven. And I just happen to keep a toaster oven in the shop just for that purpose. Okay, so we left the drift in the toaster oven at 450 for an hour, and then let it cool. And I believe it's ready to go. So the drift is made out of an old piece of jackhammer bit. It's roughly the equivalent of S2 steel. It seems like it gets relatively hard in oil, hardens a little bit better in water if it's going to be a cutting tool, but it's never going to be real hard and hold a real good edge. But it's a good tool for drifts. So I like making drifts out of it. In use, this is going to get a dull red at times, so it doesn't really have to be hardened and tempered, but I do it anyways just because I can't stop myself, I guess. So that should be a good tool. We have our punch made out of a piece of sucker rod, which is roughly the equivalent of 4130. Some of it might be 4140. You can actually tell if you look at the serial numbers on the sucker rod, they'll actually tell you what they are. But you have to have a chart to look it up, and I don't have that chart, so it doesn't do me any good. But this is going to be a good punch for our hammer. You can go back and clean these up on the grinder, polish them up if you want to, but it really doesn't matter because they're going to get bunged up and nasty looking in use anyways, and you're going to have to clean them up after a few uses to keep them in good shape, which is just a habit you should get into. So that's our video for today. We've talked about hammers and what makes a good hammer in the previous video, and we've talked about the tools needed to make a hammer in this video, these being made from scrap steel, which everybody loves to use. Again, if you can afford it and have a source, buying new steel is more reliable. You know what you've got. You don't need to go through the test procedure, and you're less likely to have failures. But blacksmiths love scrounging. They love scrap steel, and it's good recycling. So if you've got stuff, go ahead and use it. Just be cautious. Make sure you wear your safety glasses, because if you get the hardening and tempering wrong, you could be sending chips flying around the shop. So we will see you later to make a hammer. And we'll see how these tools work, and I'll show you a few little tricks to make hammer making a little bit easier for the novice. In the meantime, please subscribe to the channel. Give me a thumbs up if you like the videos, and give me a thumbs down if you don't. That's the only way I'm going to know what you want to see. Leave a comment, watch a few of the other videos. If you want to support the channel financially, there is a link to PayPal in the description of the video. And I'm more than happy to accept donations to help fund the expense of filming the videos. So head off to the shop, stay safe, wear your safety glasses, and we'll see you later.